You stand before Rottinger of Ansbach, first of his name, builder of joints, the unsober, lord of the yutz, protector of the morning woods, master of the half-debile grin, his grace. He is a good friend of mine. That is why I enjoy making face swaps with him. For example, Marty. Rotty Wizzo. Harry Potty, Osama Binotti, Vinilotti, Rotti Hotel, Neil Brody. And if you enjoy these, there is a wonderful Instagram page dedicated to these beautiful face swaps. The reason why I'm bringing this guy up is because I gave him the opportunity to pick a movie I should review without a question for each season of The Movie Void. And today we have come to this film. The reason why we're doing this one is because this bloke thinks I watch too little sci-fi. Which I truly do. Like, where it's still Event Horizon, where it's still Star Wars, that's still good. I can still deal with that. But as soon as it gets to that Star Trek overspacey level, I don't feel like it anymore. So I'm hoping this isn't as dreadful as I'm dreading it to be. Oh look, it's Teletoddy. Why, hello there, and welcome to The Movie Void, where once a season, we do a movie fashion Rotty wants us to do. And today we're doing none other than Stargate. Remember back in a way simpler time, before Michael Bay came along with all his stupid explosions, we had a man who was Michael Bay, just with a lot better scripts. Not necessarily explosions, but the world was always ending. Houses were falling apart. Aliens were coming in. There was a lot of bang. There was a lot of action. And this guy has brought us Independence Day. He has brought us 2012. He has brought us the day after tomorrow. He has brought us all sorts of shit. And I am talking about Roland Emmerich. And Stargate was the film that put Roland Emmerich onto the map. This was the film that made him famous, this was the film that made him big, and that allowed him to do all these gigantic projects that followed in the future. It even went so far that this TV show that lasted for many, many seasons came to life after this film. Now that's pretty much all the background information I have on this shindig. I have no idea what is going to be going on in this, so let's just dive right in and find out what happens. So we open up the first 3 minutes with these zoom shots of some stones. You can't really make out what it is while the credits roll by. Oh, and then at the end we do find out what it is. It is a little statue. Why isn't that marvelous? We are then thrown into Egypt in 1928, where everything looks like they've ripped it off from Raiders of the Lost Ark. And there's this archaeologist who has been sent there, it seems, to see something special. And that certain something is this gigantic circular object. Oh, what is it? We are then thrown into some reading or some press conference from a certain sir called Dr. Daniel Jackson, who is played by, let me check the name, James Spader. What did he do? Who's James Spader anyway? He was in The Blacklist, The Homesman, Lincoln. Speaking of sex, Seinfeld. Lots of stuff I really didn't give a flying rat's ass about.
Look, rat's ass.
Well, anyway, Dr. Jackson is arguing about how the pyramids were built and who really built them and yada, yada, yada. And nobody seems to care for the stuff he's saying. They all think he's talking about a bunch of bullshit. And leave the house.
I think we have to begin to reevaluate everything we've come to accept about... I've been able to show...
So Jackson leaves the joint in the pouring rain and is intercepted by this car where this old woman is sitting in. And she offers him a job.
Job.
What kind of a job?
What kind of money?
I owe him some money.
What kind of money?
I owe him some money.
What kind of money?
I owe him some money.
What kind of money? Just tell me.
I owe him some money.
Translation. Ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs.
We also find out that...
you've just been evicted from your apartment.
And if he wants to prove his theory, this is the only way he could. So, this job seems to be this guy's only hope. Then we move to a house in the suburbs, it seems. And these Navy people are walking in. And this woman, she's smoking relentlessly.
Mrs. O'Neill, is your husband in?
Yes.
Do you think we might be able to speak with him?
Who is Kurt Russell, who, as we see, is just about to kill himself. But he doesn't do so. And these men are there to tell Kurt Russell that he has...
been reactivated.
He's not really that pleased nor too upset about it. We don't really, can't really judge his reaction. He's just a grumpy old man. Me. And they leave... the house and mention that
the guy's a mess. How'd he get like that? His kid died.
We are then brought to Jackson, who seems to have taken the job the woman has offered to him. So Jackson sees this thing and sees that they've been trying to translate what it has been saying and that they haven't been doing a good job translating it, so he gets into action.
Well, this should read, 1 million years into the sky is Ra, sun god, sealed and buried for all time. This left door to heaven is... Stargate.
Don't you love it when they say the title of the film in the movie you're watching?
The Big Lebowski!
Dead Man Walking!
Con Air!
Men in Black!
Raging Bull!
Bruce Almighty!
Fight Club!
Pineapple Express!
Taxi Driver!
The Prince's Bride!
Some Like It Hot!
Start for 10!
Step Brothers!
The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance!
Super Mario Brothers!
Jackson then asks a fascinating question!
Oh, so why is the military so interested in 5,000-year-old Egyptian tablets?
My report says 10,000.
Afternoon, Colonel.
Do I know you?
I'm Colonel Jack O'Neill from General West's office.
And he seems to be in charge of the entire mission. So Jackson starts doing some research and shit. And before you know it, he is standing in this room in front of a lot of important people.
Right here, right.
And he explains what he has found out.
Okay. All right, we're obviously looking at a picture of the cover stones. Now, on the outer track, these figures that you would believe to be words to be translated were, in fact... Sorry about that. Were, in fact, star constellations.
He's onto something, because he figured out that...
Now, these constellations were placed in a unique order, forming a map or an address of sorts. 7 points to outline a course to a position. And, to find a destination within any three-dimensional space, we need 6 points to determine an exact location.
You said you needed 7 points.
Well, no, 6 for the destination. But to chart a course, you need a point of origin.
Yeah! Jackson, he's a guy. Well, it seems that he has cracked the code, and that there is this device that he has to see.
What is that?
It's your Stargate.
Eternal sunshine of a spotless mind.
The Breakfast Club.
Shutter Island.
He's a serious man.
The last king of Scotland.
District 9.
Big Fish.
The Warrior.
Training Day.
United 93. Vertigo.
Wrongfully accused.
Doubt.
Ocean's 11.
In Bruges.
I'm a dude.
Rear Window.
The Police Academy.
I am intrigued. Okay, everyone. So far, I gotta say, this is a lot better than I expected. I was expecting all these spaceships and all these people looking like mutants and these aliens and a lot of numbers and things that don't make sense. But so far, this is okay. Marilyn Monroddy. Wasn't that wrong about things. Good job. So they start this gadget, and I'm just thinking, how fucking big must their electricity bill be? For fuck's sake, look at all of this! So Jackson figures out the code to open the Stargate, and before you know it, this happens! BAM! Now this movie's getting somewhere. So they send this little robot thing into the Stargate to record what is on the other side. Well, it seems that wherever that little gadget went to is somewhere deep off into space. Poof, puff, pam, it's gone.
Right, Jackson. It's on the other side of the known universe.
And, wherever this is a place where life is possible. There is oxygen, there is good pressure, and so on and so on.
These readings tell us it's an atmospheric match. Barometric pressure, temperature, and most importantly, oxygen.
And they're thinking of sending a team inside to check out what's going on over there, and are including Jackson because of his wonderful encoding skills.
You're on the team.
So before they go, this woman gives good old Jackson a lucky charm.
I found it with Stargate when I was a child. It has brought me luck. You can bring it back to me.
And then they're off! And so Jackson walks into the Stargate, and this happens. Reminds you of the bathtub in Witchery? So he goes through the portal and the first thing he sees is Kirk or Douglas's face.
All right, it's over.
Stay with him.
Jackson's listening. Keep moving.
I wouldn't want to see Kirk Douglas's face after a portal. It's just not a nice welcome. Well, they do start some exploring and have this Toto, we are not in Kansas anymore moment.
I knew it.
Kirk Russell's team wants to look around some more, and it's Jackson's move to figure out a way to get home. However, he needs some kind of tablets, like on Earth, where it says how to get home. And he was expecting those to be there, but they are not.
Your job here is to realign the Stargate. Can you do that or not?
I can't.
You can't or you won't.
I can decipher the symbols on the Stargate, but I need an order of alignment. Now, those coordinates were marked on tablets back on Earth, and there must be something like that here. And I just need to find it.
And the crew seems very upset about this because they were thinking this was a sure thing. So Kirk Russell is building some high-tech gun, or whatever it is. It looks fucking badass. While Jackson is getting bullied by the rest of the team. So while Jackson is gathering his things together, he spots the first animal on this planet. And it looks somewhat of a, like a crossing between a buffalo and Barbara Streisand. So Jackson decides to get all friendly with this little motherfucker. And then this happens. Oh, isn't this such a fun little dragging thing? Oh, I'm so delighted. No, really, this is fucked up. It's cool. So after the Barbara Bison pulls down Jackson through the desert, they suddenly discover civilization. So they make themselves visible to this new townsfolk and send Jackson to do the talking since he's
the linguist.
Well, they see this in his necklace and start thinking that he is some kind of a god. Well, I'm liking how this movie's done so far. It's making a lot of sense with its theories, like with the sci-fi actually makes sense. For anybody, even people who aren't like that into science fiction generally. The only thing is, like, most of the characters seem quite one-dimensional. Well, other than Kirk Russell, Dr. Jackson, and that old woman, none of these characters really seem to be, like, anything special. Everybody else is just, like, thrown in to be there, but the other three, they're well established, and I like the way this is going. I like the way the story is being told. Kirk Russell also tries to talk to someone.
Ah!
And this is exactly how I'd react too, if Kirk Russell would try to talk to me. So then all of a sudden, this big ass leader of theirs appears. And his makeup is fucking terrible. Well, they exchange words. They exchange foods. So while Jackson, Kirk Russell, and the gang are checking out this alien party with the terrible makeup leader.
Tastes. Tastes like chicken.
The rest of the crew is experiencing some badass weather, and they ain't dealing. It seems to be this unusual sandstorm, and everybody is trying to get to safety. They discover an Egyptian symbol, the Eye of Ra, to be precise, and they're thinking maybe they'd know more Egyptian symbols, so Jackson does this.
Bayaka.
Only to discover that.
No.
What a weird culture. Now, things weren't already weird as shit anyway. All of a sudden, all these women are called to take Jackson away. And then they wash him and marry him to some random chick. I'm not even joking. Jackson is suddenly married on this planet. And his newfound wife seems to know a lot more than we first thought. Because when she dares to look at the writings Jackson's been writing to the ground, we find out that she knows about Earth.
Earth. You know the symbol? You know the symbol? You've seen the symbol?
We cut back to the crew guarding the Stargate and the pyramid. And they can't really work with the storm outside. But then suddenly the alien planet that they're on gets invaded by aliens. And these aliens, they look like Egyptian symbols. This is some wacky shit. While that's going on, Jackson is languagizing. Or something like that. Linguisticking. Speaking in tongues. You know what I'm saying. And while that is going on, the other crew guarding the Stargate is getting dragged away by living Egyptian symbols. So Kirk Russell and his boys are trying to make contact with the crew that is at the moment getting its ass handed to them by the Egyptian symbols, but they can't establish anything.
More interference? No. They're simply not there.
Kirk Russell comes back and starts looking for Jackson, but they don't really know what he's saying and just keep imitating what he's doing, which... it's actually quite a funny scene. Until they finally identify Jackson as Chicken Man.
Eek! Bah! Bah, bah, bah!
Chicken. 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 Chicken Man, you got it.
Gero!
Okay, maybe they're confusing him with Tommy Wiseau, but... it seems that they know what Kirk Douglas is looking for. So they sent one of them, Barbara Streisand Bisons, to go look for him. So Kirk Russell eventually does find Jackson, and he's gotten more acquainted with everything. He's figured out what the language is, it's just...
an ancient Egyptian dialect. I mean, like the rest of their culture, it's evolved completely independently, but once you know the vowels...
and he's also closer to figuring out how to get back home, but he's still missing the seventh symbol.
It's worn off. I can't make it work without the seventh symbol.
So it seems that this raw... figured out this whole entire Stargate technology thing, and he enslaved everybody on this planet and called himself a ruler by possessing somebody's body. And he was doing the same thing on Earth, but on Earth there was
a rebellion or uprising, and the Stargate was buried there.
So fearing that there would be like this revolution also on this planet, he forbid reading and writing there. So Jackson and Kirk Russell and the gang get back to where the Stargate is located and discover that A few things have changed while they were gone, and there's suddenly an alien ship on top of this pyramid. So they're encountered by this alien race, and they see that there is no point in fighting them because their technology is sort of superior than theirs, and now they have to, as Daenerys Targaryen would say,
bend the knee.
So Kurt Russell decides to be a bad boy and fights back, but just brings them into more shit. Kurt Russell finds himself in the sewers with the rest of the boys. Except for Jackson. Unhappy with what Kurt Russell and Jackson have caused on this planet, the aliens step on to some spaceships and decide to blow a couple of things up just to teach everybody who's boss. Which stirs a lot of panic among the society there. Jackson wakes up in a tomb, finds out that he was dead, but he has been brought to life again. Just so he can talk to Ra, and Ra seems to be very pissed off. And he's planning to take one of the bombs they brought along and mix it with one of their minerals and send it back to Earth and blow everything up. And to top it all off, Ra also wants Jackson to kill everyone in his crew to prove to the people of this planet that he is the only true god. Sort of reminds you of the Bible, don't you think? Back to Jackson's wife and the people of this planet. Jackson's wife has now got all this information from Jackson and knows how their people got enslaved by Ra. And she won't stand for this! So they're cooking something up. And before you know it, the execution of our Earthlings begins. As already mentioned before, Jackson is forced to kill his colleagues. But what will Jackson do? Exactly, Jackson fires back. The whole entire alien folk now knows how to use guns and is all about the rebellion, and they're striking back. What I'm getting a lot from this movie is, like, you can totally notice the early stages of Emmerich's movie styles. Like, this has Independence Day written all over it. Same with The Day After Tomorrow. It's always about people fighting for freedom, fighting for what's right. It's fun! So this whole entire war breaks loose, evening sets in, and the whole entire crew is gathered together.
And they're not exactly special forces, but they sure were.
And Kurt Russell explains why he even took the bomb from Earth to this planet to begin with at all.
My orders were simple. Track down signs of any possible danger. If I found any, blow up the Stargate.
And the dark moment of despair in this movie sets in. And as the evening progresses, Jackson encounters a little surprise.
Husband.
Jesus Christ, Jackson! I mean, come on, seriously, how dense do you have to be? Even a fucking pothead like me knew that you were married. A few moments later, we find Jackson in a conversation with this young kid.
Argu nanache.
connect the moons. This is a symbol for this planet. That's it. The point of origin.
What are you doing?
I found it.
What are you talking about?
The seventh symbol.
Yeah. And the war breaks loose and this epic fighting starts going on. This is where Kirk Douglas also sets up the bomb to destroy the Stargate. And tells Jackson that he will destroy it on the other side and just has 7 minutes time to get out of there. Yeah. Bail out, this fucking war is happening. Why don't you just... So this epic, enormous war keeps going, this great epic fight, and I am not going to go into it, because these are things I don't do in reviews. You guys gotta check out the movie if you want to see the final epic fight. It's really nice. It's one of the really exciting parts of the movie. Anyway, the people of the planet start their rebellion against Ra, and Ra notices that there is no chance that he can win this fight, so he takes off. And now that Ra is taking off, they don't want to destroy the Stargate anymore, but they can't stop the bomb. So Kirk Russell and Jackson have a wonderful idea in how they can use the technology of Ra against him. And so they do just that. Saved and everybody is happy. And strangely, Jackson decides not to leave this planet and stay here and live a life with these aliens. Yeah, well, I don't know. Yeah, well, I guess he's been evicted and everything back at home, so I guess this is like the best thing to do. He can guard the Stargate here and Kirk Russell can do it over there. Whoop-de-woo. And they all lived happily ever after. No, I think that this is exactly where the TV show kicks in. So anybody wanting to know what happens with Jackson and his adventures on this planet, please check out the TV shows. So, that was Stargate. It's fun. It's okay. It's alright. I expected Roddy Targaryen to bring more sci-fi mumbo-jumbo into this world. But instead, what I got was the beginnings of the epicness that Emmerich's movies then became. The step one of Mr. Michael Bay with brains, I'd like to call him, because he has the explosions, only these explosions in his movies make sense, and they fit the tone of his movies. So this was step one to something very big that followed on. I'm glad I got to see that. So this is a totally fun movie. Don't expect anything like of enormous epic proportions and greatness. It's all right. It's not amazing as fuck, but it's cool. So check that out if you like it. All right. So with all that being said, this was the Movie Void. You will see me when you see me. And I am out. Oh no, I'm going to go like this.
paw, paw.
Chicken. 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 Chicken man, you got it.